in the late 1840s, but in fact that one seems to have quite a long history. It was published previously in a previous group of consolations, and it seems to actually come from the 1830s, in when Liszt was in his 20s, and it was called at that time Madrigal, which brings me to the subject of tonight, Franz Liszt and the directions he went in, especially beyond the piano. The general public, I was about to say most of you, but I mean many of you, but there's not that many of you, so I'll say the general public. The general public tends to think of Liszt in terms of just virtuoso pieces, and perhaps even slightly superficial show-off pieces. Not that the first piano concerto is anything for me, but absolutely gripping in many ways. But the transcendental studies, although extremely epic in scale, don't even really give a hint of what was to come later in Liszt's life. A lot of Liszt's compositions, I feel, reflect the influence of song and really try to emulate the human voice in the way they're written. All over the place you see not just ritenuto, but even marks like con la voce, with the voice in Liszt, as if the top part is actually being sung. Or, for example, molto cantabile, frequently used in piano writing, yes, in a very singing style, but the actual way the melodic lines work, I find, are so vocal. He and his friend in Paris in the 30s, Frédéric Chopin, were equally inspired by the operas and songs of the bel canto composers, particularly Bellini, and I will bring you, a very large piano transcription of, a paraphrase in fact, of bits of his great opera Norma in the second half. But besides song taking Liszt's inspiration way beyond the piano, his very existence in the mid-1800s means that he was really at the soul of the Romantic movement in all the arts, but of course, especially music. Which meant that music at that stage, especially to him, rather than the more academic school of composers, was aiming to find many inspirations outside music, especially in literature and history, mythology, and for Liszt in particular, religion. I'll come to all that in a minute. But just the other side of this talk is entitled Before the Phonograph. In the 19th century, of course, there were no recordings. In fact, there were also very few orchestras, very few symphony orchestras, only in the main cities. So many people actually knew how to read music, there was bourgeois existence, in always entailed having a piano at home. So many people were actually conversant with music and could at least read music, that music was, of course, mostly disseminated through publishing and through people playing music, performing music. Liszt was such a generous person in so many ways. He gave piano lessons once he was independently wealthy, which happened while he was in his 20s as a piano virtuoso. He gave all his lessons for free. He supported financially and in his advocacy many composers, particularly Berlioz and Wagner, but also some Russian composers, including Bardin at one point. His generosity comes over in the sheer number of transcriptions he wrote of other people's music, of which I'll play several tonight. And both those strains, the vocal strain and the way he could emulate totally different instruments and groups of instruments, orchestras, gypsy bands even, at the piano, come together in his larger opera transcriptions, of which I'll play three tonight. Liszt, as Franz Liszt as we know him, and as he was actually born, and or called himself later on, when he really adopted his Hungarian mantle, so to speak, Liszt Ferenc, was a great prodigy. We don't even hear so much about that, but apparently he knew about his father, who was a violinist, a pianist, a guitarist, and a cellist, and member of the Esterházy court. He actually knew Joseph Haydn. brought up his son rather strictly in terms of musical education, put thousands of pages of literature in front of him, which he purchased about, they think about 2,000, they didn't call them folios, they were, music was arranged in groups of 8 pages at that time, and he did about, he learned about 2,000 of those folios by the time he was 12, apparently. He gave concerts all around Europe. Beethoven kissed him on the forehead in 1824 when he heard him for the first time and said, this is a genius. But soon Liszt was in one of his many crises, precipitated at first by the father of his sweetheart at that time in 1828 when he was 16, Caroline de Saint-Cricq, who was the daughter of a member of the French government at that time. Her father prohibited the marriage. Liszt had what we now consider to be a nervous breakdown, and his way out of it was actually through religion, the Catholic religion, which he'd been very close to even as a child. He'd been reading a lot of that. And in the next few years, he became great friends with two great thinkers in Paris at that point. He'd left his native Hungary, an area of Hungary bordering with Austria, when he was virtually a child. His father was given money by noble families to educate Liszt, in fact, in Vienna. But by the time he was in his mid-teens, he already moved to Paris. So he got to know in his early 20s the poet and later, briefly, president of France, Alphonse de Lamartine. I guess that's something we can't really conceive of these days, a major romantic poet actually becoming president of the country. He was known, especially in 1820, he had published his Méditation Poétique, Poetic Meditations, for which he was famous all through the 19th century, although French have forgotten him a little bit. He was also a philosopher and a follower of the thoughts of, again, someone who we forgot a little bit, the Count of Saint-Simon, an 18th century figure who was actually the originator of a lot of socialist thought. Both John Stuart Mill and Karl Marx were extremely familiar with his writings. He thought, for instance, that marriage was an institution which was grossly unfair to the woman, which was nearly act as imprisoning a woman in its strictures, in its denial of a woman to express herself artistically, scientifically. He foresaw a lot of the changes in the 19th century, the industrialization, the increase in education, and saw that society would have to change and would no longer be divided into so clearly a worker class, and as he called it, an idle class. But for society to go forward, there would be increased education and there would be very different structures of government. He was very, very right. The other person who was very close to Liszt at that time was a man by the name of Chrétien Urhan, who was a violinist and in fact became the concertmaster of the Paris Opera Orchestra. He was also a composer, and he and Liszt had a very strong partnership in which they played violin and piano together in certain circumstances we couldn't conceive of. For instance, in the Saint-Eustache Church in Paris, one of the great churches of Paris, in the middle of the Mass, they played no less than Beethoven's Kreutzer Sonata. Can't imagine that in a Catholic church these days either. Urhan was a major champion of the music of Beethoven and Schubert in Paris, and was also responsible for getting Abenik, who got together an orchestra to perform Beethoven symphonies for the first time. The Eroica in particular was heard by both Berlioz and Liszt and marked them hugely. And Urhan had really introduced Liszt to the music of Franz Schubert, in particular his songs. And by the 1840s, when Liszt was doing concert tours all around Europe, he had written quite a few paraphrases, transcriptions, direct transcriptions of Schubert songs, of which I'm going to play you, if I have a chance, a couple. The first one is Die junge Nonne, the young nun. And the poem by a friend of Schubert's, not a very famous poet at all, concerns a nun who's watching a storm outside getting stronger and stronger. She describes the, in the first verse the storm to describe. In the second verse, she starts to speak and she tells us how her life and her soul were as in disarray as the countryside in a storm. And in the third verse, she says, now discovering that her bridegroom is Christ, retiring from monastery, she's found a peace unlike any other. So, the human number. Nick, would you mind me helping with the answers? One very interesting thing about all the transcriptions is that they change the dynamics of Schubert quite... Maybe they don't change the dynamics. There are lots of parts of Schubert where dynamics and even accents and expression is not necessarily clearly indicated, but one is also expected, of course, to follow the sense of the words. Liszt makes this explicit, as well as introducing, of course, changes of what I call instrumentation, adding octaves, making the coloured tremolos fuller, giving a more orchestral sound to the whole piece. And the most striking aspect of his arrangements is that they include quite stark changes in tempi, which I feel work incredibly well. And it's interesting to think that performance practice, what we call now performance practice, we are just so wedded to what appears to be on the page, we wouldn't even consider doing the scale of tempo changes that Liszt actually describes.
Thank you.
play a transcription of Liszt of one of his own pieces. Again, in his late 20s, he wrote the first versions of songs he would revise several times in his life, set to sonnets by the Italian Renaissance poet and a poet who the Romantics really considered a great inspiration, especially for lyric love poems. We call him in English Petrarca. And let me just read you the words of this poem in Italian, because it really will give you a sense of the passion of the poem, and I'll try and translate them as I go. It's really much, very much Liszt's own story of being in torture from love. Pace non trovo e non ho da far guerra. I find no peace and I do not make war. E temo e spero, I fear and I hope. Ed ardo e sono un ghiaccio, I burn and yet I freeze. E volo sopra il cielo e giaccio in terra. I fly above the heavens and plunge to earth. E nullo stringo, and I hold nothing. E tutto il mondo abbraccio, and I embrace the whole world. Tal ma in prigion che non apre né serra. So much she has me imprisoned, she has me locked in a prison which she never opens nor locks. Né per suo mi ritien, né scioglie il laccio. She neither keeps me for herself, nor loosens the bond between us. E non m'uccide amor, and love does not kill me. E non mi sferra, and yet does not unbind my chains. Né mi vuol vivo, né mi trae d'impaccio. It doesn't want me alive, but it causes me no harm. Vecchio senza occhi, I see without eyes. E non ho lingua, e grido. I have no tongue, yet I cry out. E bramo di perir, I want to perish. E chiedo aiuto, yet I ask for help. Ed ho in odio me stesso, ed amo altrui. And I hate myself, and I love someone else. Pasco mi di dolor, piangendo rido. I nourish myself on sorrow. I laugh, weeping. Egualmente mi spiace morte e vita. Both life and death displeases me equally. In questo stato son donna per voi. I am in this state, a woman, for, because of you.
Thank you.
piano wasn't actually invented till the 1880s. Like the first industrial manufacturing was not till the 1890s. So Liszt was, throughout his life, a great advocate of Schubert in particular, but also of Beethoven. He wrote these amazing transcriptions of Beethoven's symphonies, which a couple of, there's a pianist who recorded them all about 20 years ago by the name of Cyprian Katsiris, who became so convinced by them he prefers them to the original orchestral variety. In 1830, Liszt wrote his revolutionary symphony after one of the many uprisings and turnovers of government in France, which happened around then. Yet he hadn't quite finished it when he met the penniless Berlioz, who was just managing to get his Symphonie Fantastique actually performed. So Liszt, besides giving him money to for the first performance, for subsequent performances, and which he arranged in many cities of Europe, also started including a transcription of the whole Symphonie Fantastique, 55 minutes long, on many of his concert programs. And not that we have much time, but maybe I'll show you just a little extract from it, if I can. I'd take a request. Anyone would choose a movement? Or perhaps I'll play just a little bit of the first Allegro in the, maybe even the transition to the first Allegro, which is quite remarkable in itself. This actually brings me to a really interesting point, that also Liszt, not only in his transcriptions, change registrations, tempi, but also sometimes harmonies. Those of you who know the Junge Nonne might have found a few interesting changes in Liszt's own version. So, besides his immense mastery in imitating, or at least suggesting, the scope and changes of colour in a full orchestra, he wrote also 20-something Hungarian rhapsodies. He said that when he was a child, his most strongest musical memories were in fact of the gypsy bands who came to play in the town he grew up in. Strangely enough, that town is only about 50 miles from where Haydn was born. We never really think of them being nearly from the same area, but they were. And that's, I guess, why his father happened to get a good job at the Esterházy court, where Haydn was a master of music, of course. So I'm going to show you a few things about the Gypsy style. Liszt actually considered himself to be Hungarian, although he didn't speak any Hungarian. And the further his life went, though, the more connections he had directly with Hungary. Although, of course, he spent his young adulthood in Paris after he started living with Marie Dagoult, and he had two kids. He lived further in Paris, but once that finished, and he met, I think, about his sixth mistress at that point, it became quite serious. the Countess of Sayn-Wittgenstein was married, and so Liszt and she went decamped to Rome to attempt to get dispensation from the Pope, so to declare the previous marriage invalid, so that Liszt could actually marry her. But that didn't happen. So life changed, and Liszt spent the next few years actually bumping between Rome, Weimar, where he was master of music for the court, and Hungary, where he was more and more illustrious and welcomed. In any case, the early Hungarian rhapsodies, most of them are in the csárdás form. That is to say, they start with either a sorrowful, slow introduction, like the best known of them, the second. Or sometimes, even if the induction is slow, relatively slow, it's more martial and celebratory, like the sixth, which actually has a tune which is still known in Hungary. And the 12th, I remember when I was a kid and started reading these for the first time, my father, who actually was Hungarian, started singing along. It's the tune of that is called the Carnival of Pest, you know, the lower part of Budapest, which is a twin city, Buda and Pest. It's called the Carnival of Pest, and the melody goes like this. Hungarian always has the accent on the first syllable. These earlier pieces, though, are not so obviously Hungarian melodies, but music made by the gypsies in the Roma, I should call them now, in Western Hungary at that time. So I was saying, the sixth one starts with a rather full orchestra introduction. Gypsy bands were mainly string bands, but usually had a prominent solo violin, a solo double bass, sometimes an wind instrument of the oboe of the clarinet family. There was a folk one called the, I forgot his name, starts with, "Are there any Hungarians here?" Tararato or something like that. It's a very noisy instrument. During the 19th century, it was replaced by the clarinet for the most part. And the most typical member of the ensemble, of course, is the cimbalo, the dulcimer, the amazing instrument which is in a box about this size with two intersecting set of strings, which is played with wooden hammers. And most of the time, its particular sound comes from the fact that there are no dampers on the strings. In fact, it has a sort of reverse pedal. Every now and then, you push the pedal down, and the strings get damp. Oh, sorry, but first, the pizzicato polka. Answered by the full string orchestra. Liszt marks this as if improvised. Thank you. gets faster and faster. Style in the 1880s. Liszt, who died in 85, had his first major health crisis only when he was 70 in 81. We now think he started to have heart failure and was blacking out a little bit. He fell down a set of steps, hurt himself quite considerably, and never was quite the same. His whole attitude to life became even more religious and by turns religious and bitter. And at this time, he started experimenting with some quite amazing harmonies. And in his Hungarianly influenced pieces, he started actually using local melodies, which he heard for the first time. So the Csárdás, the last Csárdás he wrote, he called the Csárdás Macabre. And he started, so it has really interesting harmonic experiments in it. And one of the themes in it is a very interesting cross between a very famous Hungarian children's song, which goes like this. And if you notice, those first few notes are the same as the dies irae. Play the first few pages of this and give you a flavour of where Liszt was going in the last years of his life. He was going much beyond the piano. He was widening the harmonic scope and even the emotional possible impact. Probably the best known. And since it's also reasonably short, I'll play it to you now before we take a break. Liszt, again, in the 1840s, made his largest concert tours of Europe and took a few of these earlier opera transcriptions, which he made on most of the popular operas. And again, this sort of combines both of these strands that I'm organizing this talk around tonight. He went beyond the capabilities of the piano in many ways by suggesting the voice, the combinations of voices, orchestral colors, and at the same time, he was taking these pieces, these operas, to places who would never hear a performance of those operas for many, many years. The paraphrase on Rigoletto is completely centered on the quartet in the third act, which is perhaps the climax in many ways of the piece, where the greatest conflicts happen. The philandering Duke, who has seduced, not just seduced, but abducted, thanks to its courtiers, the highly protected, nearly walled-in young daughter of the court jester, Rigoletto, has been released from the Duke's palace, still in love with the Duke of Mantua. Rigoletto has arranged to have the Duke murdered in revenge for kidnapping and seducing his daughter. And he has enticed, he has managed to get the Duke to be enticed to have an assignation with the innkeeper's daughter at a nearby inn. And at the beginning of the quartet, you hear them flirting with each other. Then Rigoletto and his daughter Gilda come in and watch what's happening from the outside. And the four characters are highly contrasted. Maddalena, the innkeeper's daughter, laughing, flirting, and there's a hint of sorrow in her lines. The Duke, carefree, amorous, and in Liszt's particular version, I really feel that in the second verse, when you hear the initial melody, it's as if he's no longer serenading her, but they've actually gone upstairs. Liszt actually colours the music very differently from Verdi, you see. And witnessing all this is the outrage, despairing Gilda and her father saying, "I told you so. I told you so." As is usual in Liszt's transcriptions from this period, there is a short, somewhat virtuoso introduction which introduces a couple of themes and, of course, a brilliant bring down the curtain finale.
Thank you.
of Wagner's more serious fantasies on operas, first the reminiscence de Norma, memories of Norma. Norma is a great opera by Bellini, which is not actually performed very often anywhere because it makes such colossal demands on the title role. Briefly, the story is of a Druid priestess. Okay, we are in the British Isles at the period of the Romans, and the Romans are invading Britain, and the Druids are defending themselves against the Romans. Norma, the high priestess, unfortunately has fallen in love with the general of the Roman army. That's the way opera goes. She has had two children and brings them up in secret. And she and Poglione, the general, have parted company, nevertheless. Unbeknownst to her, Poglione has left her for an acolyte, another one of the priestesses, a young priestess named Adalgisa. And when Norma finds out about it, she is conflicted between whether she should stop the relationship by denouncing Adalgisa or keeping silent. She finally is about to accuse Adalgisa of treachery and betrayal when she suddenly puts it together in her head that it's her who is the traitor, and she doesn't betray her close friend and instead proclaims her own guilt. This paraphrase, so to speak, very cleverly by Liszt, covers about three scenes of the opera. It starts with the prayer of the Druids to defeat the invading Romans, turns into a blood-curdling march, and then jumps basically to the end of the opera, where Norma confesses her sin and asks her peers for forgiveness, and the very final scene where she and Poglione have been condemned to death by walking into fire. There is a very strange link, which I haven't seen documented, between this and the Liebestod of Wagner, the end of the opera Tristan and Isolde, which was written 1831, 1868, 37 years later. Wagner was always a great admirer of Bellini. You wouldn't think of that as an obvious link with Bellini's insistence on the attention being completely on the melodic line and the orchestra and the accompaniment being secondary, where with Wagner, the drama was going on so much of the orchestra and the voices basically enunciate their direct thoughts and nearly declaim many of their lines. Well, Wagner thought Bellini was a great opera composer. And the end of Tristan and Isolde, of course, is also about a doomed couple. And I'm playing these one after another because I even find a musical link between the end of the opera Norma, where you have these phrases in actually close sequence which build upon each other, much like the Liebestod, before it reaches its climax. I think I'll just leave you to hear that by yourself. These last two scenes in the opera that Liszt brings alive for the piano are separated by a sudden flashback to, which works very well dramatically in the absolute sense of the piece. Liszt always emphasized in his writings, he wrote also very on many occasions about the future of music, and the future of music for him was incorporating extra musical elements. He wrote basically what was an apology for Berlioz's piece, Harold in Italy, which is a great viola solo with orchestra, which describes Lord Byron's poem. puts it virtually puts the whole story to music. And Liszt always emphasized the fact that the programmatic structure of a piece must also have absolute musical strength, and it certainly does in the case of this great paraphrase. The surprise shift of gear is to a battle scene between the Druids just about going into battle. It's a very, with the Romans, it's a very violent, probably some of the most violent music Bellini ever wrote. And Liszt transformed this into a very virtuoso section where I have to try and jump around all the keyboard at the right speed, and we'll see whether I do or not. So I'm going to play one, the Memories of Norma, which takes a lot of, quite a few liberties, adds cadenzas to the score, and straight after that I will play the Liebestod of Isolde, from Tristan and Isolde, which is one of Wagner's most literal transcriptions, aside from his transcriptions of Beethoven and Berlioz's symphonies. However, the orchestration he manages to bring forth from the piano I remember when I first played it, I was so surprised by the climax. Again, there is a similarity with the Bellini climax. The climax of the Bellini in the original opera is just full orchestra cantabile. Wagner translates these into harp-like, passionate, arpeggiating chords with lots of rubato. The climax in the Wagner is transcribed by Liszt as what I can only describe as an earthquake on the piano. It's these quickly pulsing chords at the moment of the magical subdominant, as it is called, that is the climax of the Liebestod. But even the harmonic scheme of Wagner, although more chromatic than Bellini's, bears an amazing resemblance to Bellini. Wagner was not noted for his modesty, but besides his admiration for Bellini, he was always very grateful to Franz Liszt, who in fact rescued him from the German revolution of failed revolution of 1848, where he took the wrong side, and Liszt actually smuggled him. France, and Liszt actually got him into smuggled him out into Germany and Weimar. He also lent him money on many occasions before Wagner found his ultimate financial source in Ludwig II of Bavaria, and by his own money put on one performance of Lohengrin in Weimar, which Wagner didn't even bother to attend. Liszt also performed overtures of Wagner operas all over the place when he conducted, and included several preludes of Wagner and many extracts of Wagner in his own piano concerts. This is the last Wagner transcription that he made, and as many of you know, I used to be head of music staff at the opera across the road, virtually across the road, and worked in opera quite a bit in Europe. And I played rehearsals for Tristan and Isolde about four times. The main piano scores for Tristan and Isolde, there are two. One was written by a pianist who was virtually forgotten. He was a wonderful pianist, apparently. His name was Karl Klimvort. He was also one of the conductors of the, for a few years, of the Berlin Philharmonic in the late 19th century. He wrote versions, very complicated versions, not the simplest versions, of the orchestral parts of Wagner's operas. The other transcription, so to speak, I was familiar with was von Bülow's transcription. Von Bülow also was Klimvort's pupil. Now, Klimvort was a pupil of Liszt, so all stays in the family, but even more so because Bülow was actually Liszt's son-in-law. So, close circle. And Wagner actually stole Liszt's daughter from Bülow and ended up marrying her. So, very close personal and artistic stories and some great music. So. Thank you.
Thank you.